My name is, again, it's Gerald Sticker. I am the retired chief of police for the city of Mandeville. And I'll give you just a little Reader's Digest version of who I am in my history and what I'm about personally and professionally. I'm married. I have two sons that are 30 and 27. And I have three little grandsons that are 5, 3, and 1. And love them to death, and that's one of the reasons that when I retired last June, that kind of prompted my retirement at the time, was just to spend some time with them and hoping my golf career would take off. I fancy myself a golfer, however pitiful I am at it. But you know, I am originally from Bedico, which is on the south end of the parish, and graduated Punchatoula High School in 1986. Immediately upon graduation, I entered the United States Marine Corps Reserve and took off. I did 6 years there. The last year, or the last 2 years, between 90 and 91, my unit was activated for the first Gulf War, Desert Shield, Desert Storm. So I enjoyed my time in the Marine Corps, and still have lifelong friends since the age of 17, and any of you that have served in the military and those bonds and relationships you build there are often, you know, lifelong relationships. And as Chief said, you know, I am running for sheriff here in Tangipahoa Parish, but I would ask that you look at my previous 27 years experience as a police officer in the law enforcement community. And I have a very thorough understanding and belief in relationships, because as a law enforcement agency, if you look at the average cop, everything on his belt is, you know, a gun, a taser, a stick, handcuffs, pepper spray. Everything on that man or woman's belt is to take away liberties and freedom. We need to get out of that business as much as we can, and it was always my goal in law enforcement to work with the different organizations, to work with our churches. Our churches are instrumental in making our families, you know, solid and secure. You know, organizations like, you know, the Rotary that do community service, and they meet certain needs. And my role as a law enforcement leader when I was chief of police was to augment all of those entities. I was never a member of any of those civic organizations, save the Marine Corps League. But as chief, I worked with each and every one to meet their needs when they were having, whether it was a coat drive or a luncheon, or, you know, to raise money for something. I was an ambassador for each and every one of those entities, because I wanted to see organizations like yourself succeed in your mission, because if you're succeeding in your mission, then that's a segment of the community that's covered, that, you know, we don't have to worry about. You know, there's a satisfaction that's met, and it's one less person that law enforcement has to directly get involved with. And so it's a pie in the sky. You know, it's never going to happen. The jails are always going to be full, but we got to try, you know. And that's, you know, that's been my calling in law enforcement, and I do call it a calling. You know, it was never a job to me. And every day when I went to work, I prayed for two things. Lord, put somebody in front of me that I can help, and put me in front of somebody that needs to be taken off the street. And that's every day. I just wanted to touch two people. One person that needed some help that I could help out, and somebody that needed to go to jail that would do ill or harm to the community. And that was my goal every day when I went to work. You know, as a new police officer, you know, you hear it often said, oh, they're going to go save the world. You know, it's overly optimistic. I was never that optimistic, but still, that was my sincere prayer every day, on top of, you know, safety for myself and those that I work with. And so my law enforcement career, just to kind of give you the Reader's Digest version of my 27 years, it's probably knocking on 30 years if you count my reserve time. I knew from the time I was 10 years old I wanted to do two things. I wanted to be United States Marine, and I wanted to be a police officer. And so I realized my Marine Corps dream at age 17 when I graduated Punxsutawney High School. My parents had to sign the papers because I wasn't 18 yet. I have a December birthday and I was graduating, and I knew that's what I wanted to do. And I came back, bounced around a few jobs, and I started putting applications in. And I put applications in from, because I lived in Bedico, I put applications in from Hammond, Tangipahoa Sheriff's Office, all the way to St. Tammany, Slidell Police Department. If they had a badge on their shirt, they had an application with my name on it. And as fate would have it, I landed with the city of Mandeville, and they gave me an opportunity as a reserve officer. Still working full-time, but I worked nights and weekends, worked the streets with those full-time guys, just making myself known to them and just demonstrating to them what I can do. I was hired full-time in June of 95 as a patrolman. Over the course of my career, I've worked criminal patrol, I've worked investigations, I was a school resource officer for about a year and a half in our public school system. I worked investigations where we investigated, you know, persons crimes, property crimes. After about 17 years, I worked my way up into the administration, and I was a captain over both criminal patrol and investigations, and we 90 or 2000, well, losing my dates here. About 6 years ago is when I was, it was 2016, when I was appointed chief of police. In the city of Mandeville, it's an appointed position, it's not elected. I moved back to Tangipahoa Parish last May, and while we were looking for a home permanently, an individual who I was going to be renting from pulls up and says, hey, congratulations on your upcoming retirement. It says you're running for sheriff. And I was like, hell no. And I was 100% honest with him. No. I was like, I'm burnt out. I'm just, you know. But over the last 12 months now, it just seemed like God has put a conversation in front of me that I didn't start, by friends, family that know me, that say, you know, man, you're young, you got an excellent career, you got a an awesome resume, you can fix their perceived problems. And and conversation after conversation, I just dismissed it, you know, and I was listening on my way up here too to Billy Graham when he was telling the story of Jonah and Nineveh. If you remember that story, if you're familiar with it, you know, I wasn't going to Nineveh. I felt God pulling me toward this calling, but I'm a little slow sometimes. But it took about a year for me to finally stop and say, okay, if this is what you want me to do, God, I'm going to do it. And so, I made the decision about 3 months ago to run for sheriff in Tangipahoa Parish, October 2023. God didn't promise me I was going to win. I'm fighting it. I'm going to fight, and I'm going to give everything I got to running, as meeting as many people as I can. But I do sincerely feel that God has called me out to run, And so I'm going to be obedient to that calling to whatever end it meets. And I'm ready to serve my home parish. I'm from here. My whole adult career has been in St. Tammany. And I had a good career. Got picked up my college degree along the way, bachelor in criminal justice, graduate of the FBI's National Academy, which is a 10-week executive development program that they put on in Quantico. I've worked with, local, state, and law enforcement. I have those relationships. And that's what it takes. You know, criminals, they don't have jurisdictions. They have jurisdictional boundaries here in Kentwood where the chief and his guys and gals work the city limits. Criminals don't pay attention to that. They go throughout the parish. They go through other parishes. And so it's going to take a sheriff with standing relationships with all those entities to extend law enforcement's reach. And it's going to take those community relationships, just to wrap up, to root out the problems, to flush out the problems that everybody has in their community, everybody has in their neighborhood. Somebody might have a problem with golf carts or four-wheelers or, you know, motorcycles on public streets in their neck of the woods. Another entity, it might be drugs over here. And so what may be your problem may not be your problem, but, you know, my focus and goal is to work with every organization, every entity that's in this parish, to all work for the common good. You know, I still have a daughter in school here in Tangipahoa Parish, and she goes to St. Thomas. My grandkids are here, my mom's here. I want our communities to be safe. You know, I just left Southeastern University the other night when that shooting occurred at the Hammond High graduation. My niece graduated, and to have my mom call, hyperventilating, worried about where I was at, I was like, there's no, you know, it just, you know, there's no excuse. I'm stomping out all of that. As equally as compassionate as I am about the community and helping people and helping to keep them out of jail, I'm just as passionate about putting people who need to be in jail in jail. And, I believe in doing good to the good and bad to the bad. And I'm very strong on enforcement, and because I don't want to get another one of those calls from my mom or any of my kids or family members, and I know you don't either. So my best day on the job was the first day that I put on that uniform as a reserve police officer. Wasn't getting paid for it, but I was finally I was fulfilling what I felt God called me to do. Man, I put on that uniform, I put that badge on my shirt. And, you know, it took me 2.5 years before I was hired on, before I ever got a paycheck for doing what I love to do. That's my favorite day on the job was my first day. And I look back now, and I aggravated the daylights out of those veteran officers because I was full of piss and vinegar. I just come out of the Marine Corps, and I was like, if anybody kicks off any trouble, just get out the way. I got it, you know. And I was ready to light it up. Had no idea what law enforcement was all about. And a little quick side story of that is the chief, first chief that I ever worked under. He's a big guy, and he called me one day because I was out, and he was getting on to me because I was writing citizens' tickets and all, and they would move, they were getting the ticket, and I was working hard. And he stopped me one day. He said, hey, come to the office. He says, I need you to go pick Miss So-and-so up and go take her to the grocery store and get some groceries. She didn't have any transportation. And in my naive, immature mind, as a brand new officer, I was like, it's not my job to go take people to get groceries, you know? But I went and picked that elderly lady up because he's a big guy, and he's writing my check. But he taught me something. That was the first lesson that I learned about true community service and community police. And it's a big buzzword, you know, community policing. But I started talking to that lady, and sweet soul. I went in and pushed a buggy around for her. And so that taught me the significance of relationships and true community service. It ain't all about writing tickets and putting people in jail. Looking back, that chief picked me out personally to go do that just to redirect my ignorance. And so God bless him for that. My worst day on the job, and I don't want to patronize it or get into it, but burying a police officer. Had two officers shot under my tour as chief. One of them killed, and so worst day. And again, I don't want to politicize that or patronize it, so that's all I'll say on it. But it, by far, hands down, worst day on the job. So, worst day in any community. I do believe that, you know, the Bible says, you know, Apostle Paul in the book of Romans said that God's ordained the governing authorities, and they don't bear the sword for nothing. And that when someone rebels against law enforcement, it's not only an affront to that law enforcement officer, it's an affront to the community. It's also an affront to God. And so that's my stance on it, period. And yep, best day, wasn't getting paid for it, worst day was the other. And so yeah, that was it.
Don't get beat by the heat. Call Comfort Air AC Electrical and Mechanical for all your AC and electrical needs. There's no problem too big or too small. Our licensed technicians can handle it all. We provide residential and commercial services to the North and South Shore and all of the surrounding areas in South Louisiana. We're licensed, insured, and bonded with over 10 years of providing great customer service to the community. Don't be hot this summer. Call Comfort Air today.
Bill Hood only keeps the best. Low mileage vehicles, so you get a great car while saving a ton off retail. Since 1929, the Hood family has been serving the North Shore, and now's the time to check them out. I'm Cam Jordan for the Bill Hood Import Corner in Hammond.
Carl Briggs Jr. from A-Meat has an amazing story to tell. You hardly know where to begin. It's all about local history that involves his family. So let's start with what I would suspect is the headline item. You believe and have a lot of evidence that you're a direct descendant of President Andrew Jackson.
Yes, sir. So basically the information that I uncovered was that as I was looking back through my family history, I had a grandfather by the name of Alexander Sandy Jackson, who was born somewhere between Wilmer, he was married in Wilmer, but was born somewhere in upper part of Mississippi to he was born to Polly Bankston and someone called Slave Master Jackson. That got me to looking to see who exactly would this person be in the 1850s in Mississippi area, and who would this person be. So I started to look into it, do the research to see who would be considered this, who were the plantation owners at the time, and where would this be. Come to find out that in the 1850s, the Hermitage in Tennessee was run by President Andrew Jackson, and that was he led slave master classes where he taught people how to take care of their slaves, how to capture them as well. It's a sordid history, but he was very much so known for this. After he passed away in 1845, his son, Andrew Jackson Jr., took over. His son was a great sport, a great person, but just not very good with business. And so as he was running the business and running his life, he was running it out of money. So he had to end up selling the Hermitage and try to make some of it back through plantations that he purchased, one in Mississippi, and I think there was another in Louisiana. They can't really assort that one. The one that he purchased in Mississippi was the Clifton Plantation. It was in, I believe, I can't remember the place in Mississippi, but it's a plantation that was very known. It was a very large plantation at the time. And when he purchased this plantation is the exact time that my Polly Bankston, my fourth great grandmother, had Alexander Sandy Jackson to Slave Master Jackson. Now, what's interesting, what I've even discovered further, is how they got to Louisiana. Basically, the plantation that they purchased was purchased again, and then it was a lot of unruliness going on because of the Civil War. Laws were changing, how much money was happening was changing between people. So a lot of the slaves ended up leaving and having to relocate. And a lot of them actually came to A-Meat specifically in Louisiana because of Vernontown, which was a place about 3,000 acres developed by a guy called Free Bob, I believe is what his name was, and he was a slave who worked his way into freedom, and he bought his freedom, and he bought 3,000 acres of land in the A-Meat area to develop a church, for his community to develop and to have a lot of black people to live there, and it's around the Wilmer area. That's exactly where they got married, that's where they developed their life, and that's how my family started in this area.
So Wilmer is sort of a center of this story, and that's where your great-grandmother lived.
Yes, and that's where a lot of my family still lives to this day. We have a cemetery where everyone we've ever known, all of our family, we can go back and look at all of them in the same cemetery.
So a lot of this history leads us to Steptoes, which was a lounge, but that statement doesn't tell the story of people like Aretha Franklin, who performed there back in the day. What a story.
Yes. So basically, I live on a place called Steptoe Road, and I'd always heard about, you know, that there was a club called the Steptoes. I'd heard about it from my parents because they said back in the day we had a field, and during the day, during the times when the club was going, they'd park all the cars in their field and charge them $2 to $3 a day. They made a killing back in the day with $2 and $3. And they would park the cars. They were too young to go in because they were little girls, so they would open their windows and listen to the music and hear everybody out there talking and see everything. And then the day after it would close, they'd go in and look and clean up, and they'd see all types of things there. Now, Steptoe's Lounge was one of the stops in the black music industry. You would call the Chitlin Circuit is what they called it, which was the circuit of clubs and performance venues in the segregated South that black artists, major artists, would have to come into and travel and perform there, and that's where they would make it. It was what they call a juke joint. It was the main one. And so people like Aretha Franklin, Ray Charles, Bobby Blue Bland all came through there, literally drove the exact route that I drive to get to my house, parked in my back field, and performed right across the street.
How can all of this history have just been lost? As a matter of fact, you're rediscovering it.
Yes. It hasn't been lost, but it hasn't been preserved the right way. It's been kept in the way that it has been, and the way that all the history has been kept kind of in our area by word of mouth. Everyone knows the history from their grandparents and their aunts and uncles who tell them about it, but no one from the outside really knows what all happened. And so it wasn't until I saw an article that was written about Steptoe's Lounge, and I was like, oh, I know of this place in 2013 by, I think, Gloria Steptoe in this area, where she described how important of a place it was. And I was like, you know, that really makes sense. It was that big of a place and it was that important, and the location is what played the key role in it. Because if you get off the interstate I-55, it's two turns and you get there in 2 minutes, and so that makes it an easy way for people who are traveling throughout the South to stop at this particular club and keep going.
Well, also the fact that Andrew Jackson's son, Andrew Jackson Jr., would have owned property in Tangipahoa Parish and probably had a mistress in Tangipahoa Parish. I mean, that's incredible that we would not celebrate this history.
Yes, and the thing that's interesting about that in particular is that Andrew Jackson Jr., though the son of Andrew Jackson, his legacy was not that of his father's. He just didn't make as many moves afterwards. He really kind of went down. He had a lot of misfortunes, and so people didn't really record his history as accurate, well, as strongly as they could have, except for places like the National Archive at the Hermitage. And so as he was coming through and as he was purchasing things, he loved Louisiana. He loved the land. Him and his son, they would come through and they'd view between Mississippi to New Orleans and talk about how the land was just the best ever. You could grow anything here. You can grow everything and do everything. But one of the plantations they had burned down, and it just never really recovered the way that they should have. And I can only imagine if they hadn't had that misfortune, the history that still would have been preserved had they been able to get on their feet and maintain that legacy.
Well, we happen to be at this meeting with the AME Chamber, and Congresswoman Julia Letlow just left, and you asked her about how do you get a historical marker. What strikes me about all of these things that we're talking about is that there's not even a marker. I mean, much less some other celebration of this history.
Exactly. You know, it's a shame, you know, because we know that it was such an important place. We have so many different types of history from all different types of the times, you know, from the 60s, from the Civil War, from before that. There was, you know, Tangipahoa Parish specifically was first populated by Native Americans before people came in and before the United States came in. And you would think that Louisiana would be a place where people would care a lot about history, because the Louisiana Purchase may have been the most impactful decision that the United States made that helped them to maintain and develop. But a lot of that history just hasn't been preserved or expanded upon or, you know, talked to about, as much about to the rest of the public.
So where do we go from here?
Well, where we go from here is, for one, putting those landmarks there. We have to get those there so the people can know. What's left of Steptoe's is actually, there's a wall that was for the bar. It's a beautiful wall if you think about the history of it, like that's a place where all these artists came through and did all this. We get that marker put there, and then we start educating our youth so that they can have a spark of interest and then develop the area as well.
Well, one of the things you mentioned to me just casually was that there was an actual plantation in Wilmer.
Yes.
And what struck me about that is plantation tourism is huge.
Yes.
And Blythewood is a huge attraction, but it's not really an old plantation home. It was a replica built decades after the Civil War. So we have the real deal in Wilmer, a real plantation. Again, we don't do anything with it. If it was in Virginia, they'd be making a mint off of it.
They'd be making movies about it every year. They'd be having a whole tourist attraction. They'd have it named after that place, and they'd have all the houses mimicking things about it to like have that style. But I think we just take for granted the fact that we can always talk to our grandparents and know what happened, and that we can look back and think about, oh yeah, my great-great-grandmother lived here and all that, without the rest of the country knowing.
My head is swimming, but let's at least do one thing and tell people how they can get in touch with you if they want to help, or they want to learn more, or they have some other information they'd like you to know.
Yes, if you have any way that you can help, or if you want to know any more information about it, if you have a little that you'd like to fill in the blanks for, any of the history around here, your grandmother, anyone, you can email me at carl.briggs.jr.1024@gmail.com. Or you can look me up on Facebook, Carl Briggs Jr. as well, the one that looks like me. And that would be the greatest way to contact me. I respond very quickly, and I really hope you all would want to be engaged in it. We need to develop this area. There's no reason for us to leave all this history behind because of a lack of remembrance. We need to remember everything.
Riding in style is important to me, but so is having a reliable car. That's why I do business with Bill Hood Ford Lincoln. The Hood family has been around since 1929, tackling high car prices so you too can have a stylish and reliable car. I do business with these guys, and I can tell you the short drive is well worth it. A friendly staff and a huge selection of new and certified used cars and trucks means just one thing, super savings. I'm Cam Jordan, and when you drive a little, you'll save a lot at the Bill Hood Auto Group.
We're back at WABL in A-Meet, AM and FM, where there is a new owner in town. She's Erica Taylor and has a heck of a story to tell. Well, Miss Erica, first of all, welcome to A-Meet.
Thank you so very much. I'm glad to be here.
So you say that God had a hand in bringing you to A-Meet.
Most definitely. Yes, he did. I was on the internet looking for something else, and I found this place. And when I saw it, I just had to, look up and see what it was, what it was all about. And when I found out what it was all about, actually, when I took my drive down here, it said things like, Jesus is Lord over A-Meet and welcome home. And, you know, and as I was telling you about the story of Abraham, when he said to get out from amongst your kindred and go to a place where I'll show you, you know, I'm from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, but I thank God for being a resident of A-Meet.
And so you're turning the station into a gospel format.
Oh, yes, definitely. It was an oldie station, but God laid on my heart to turn it into a 24-hour gospel station, yes.
So what will that include? I mean, obviously some music, but I noticed, too, that you're playing a lot of church services.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm playing church services on Sunday at the moment, but I'm going to be playing radio ministry broadcasts during the week as well. And the type of music that I'm playing is rated E for everyone. I have contemporary gospel, country gospel, traditional gospel, and all the above. It's rated E for everyone.
How about those Sunday church broadcasts, though? Will you be enlisting local churches?
I'll be enlisting local churches as well as churches from all over, you know, Baton Rouge and surrounding areas, A-Meet surrounding areas. I mean, Hammond, New Orleans, Mississippi, yes.
By the way, the FM 97.3, it goes a long way.
Yes, it does. It reaches a 50-mile radius.
So what role do you expect for local churches to play in spreading the word and availing themselves of this radio station now?
The role? Just to minister the word of God. Preach the word in season and out of season.
So I guess the main thing is just to invite people to tune in.
Most definitely. Tune in to WABL 1570 AM and 97.3 FM.
And the radio station is not your only business.
That's right. That's right. I have a business called Lady T Production. And with Lady T Production, I get people to minister their God-given talent, whether it's singing, dancing, comedy, poetry, excerpts from the Word of God, or whatever positive message you have to bring to the table.
How does that work? A person calls you and then what?
Actually, I call them. I call them and ask them to audition, to get up and minister their gift. You know, like I said, whether it be singing, dancing, comedy, poetry, and all Christian based.
So is there an ultimate goal to all this?
Yes, sir. There's an ultimate goal. I'm looking for an adjudicated property, a piece of property where I can turn into an event center, where people can come and have a place to go, as opposed to going to other places, you know, a good Christian place to go, and, you know, kind of trying to get them off the streets.